From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
And the facts show that Donald Trump is wrong and his chief economic advisor is wrong about every major reason that they've given to tear up Dodd-Frank. Commercial and consumer lending is robust, bank profits are at record levels, and our banks are blowing away their global competitors.
As Donald Trump surrounds himself by former Goldman Sachs bankers, from Steve Bannon to Steve Mnuchin, we'll look at how his administration's attempting to roll back Dodd-Frank and the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, which was created in response to the economic crisis a decade ago. We'll speak with Sheila Kolhatkar, author of Black Edge, Inside Information, Dirty Money, and the Quest to Bring Down the Most Wanted Man on Wall Street. Then Donald Trump falsely suggests Sweden was the scene of a recent terror attack.
You look at what's happening in Germany. You look at what's happening last night in Sweden. Sweden. Who would believe this? Sweden.
Trump's comments have left the country of Sweden baffled. The only recent terror attack in Sweden occurred when neo-Nazis bombed an asylum center in January. We'll go to Stockholm for the latest, then to Britain, where protests are taking place in the streets and in Parliament over the British Prime Minister's invitation to Donald Trump to make a state visit.
There is no way this honor should be awarded to someone who's abused women, who's abused members of the Muslim faith, who's abused migrants.
London for the latest. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Not my President's Day. That was the rallying cry nationwide as thousands took to the streets of major U.S. cities Monday for another mass day of action against President Trump. In Los Angeles, thousands gathered at City Hall to protest Trump's policies on immigration, trade and climate change. In Portland, Oregon, police in riot gear fired pepper spray and arrested 13 people at a protest outside a federal building. Thousands more took to the streets of Chicago, Philadelphia, Miami, Atlanta, Denver, Austin, Washington, D.C., as well as many other cities. In New York, protesters filled several blocks along Central Park outside Trump Tower, where thousands called for an end to Trump's crackdown on immigrants.
My name is Blanca, and I'm here for all immigrants because I am the daughter of a wonderful Mexican immigrant who worked really hard with my father to raise my brother and I and make us the great Americans that we are. And I feel that this country is made up of all immigrants, and it belongs to all immigrants. And why they want them out now is beyond me. I just don't understand it. And obviously, our president does not understand that either.
Monday's Not My President's Day protests cap off a week of mass actions against Trump and his policies, which also included nationwide protests by fast food workers against former Labor Secretary nominee Andrew Puzder last Monday, a 20,000-person rally in Milwaukee in support of immigrants and refugees on Tuesday, more than a dozen Day Without Immigrants protests nationwide Thursday, the February 17th general strike Friday, and widespread protests against Trump in major U.S. cities over the weekend. In Britain, thousands filled Parliament Square Monday to voice their opposition to President Trump as lawmakers debated whether to cancel his state visit. This is Parliament member Paula Sheriff.
Does he agree that to use the expression "grab him by the pussy" describes a sexual assault and therefore suggests that he shouldn't be afforded a visit to our Queen?
Entirely agree. I mean, his manner, his behaviour, throughout the election period, of one that's greatly worrying.
That's British Prime Minister Paul Flynn agreeing that Trump's comments captured a 2005 NBC Access Hollywood video constitute him bragging about sexual assault. Nearly 2 million Brits have signed a petition calling on President Trump's official state visit to be canceled, arguing it would cause embarrassment to the Queen. We'll go to London later in the broadcast. Back in the United States, President Trump has named General H.R. McMaster to be General Michael Flynn's replacement as National Security Advisor.
So I just wanted to announce, we've been working all weekend, very diligently, very hard, that General H.R. McMaster will become the National Security Advisor. He's a man of tremendous talent and tremendous experience.
General McMaster served in the Persian Gulf War in Afghanistan and Iraq. He's well known for his 1977 book, Dereliction of Duty, in which he criticizes Vietnam-era generals for not challenging President Johnson and Defense Secretary Robert McNamara over their strategies. McMaster recently argued for an expansion of the U.S. Army, claiming in a 2016 testimony to a Senate Armed Services Subcommittee that the Army, quote, risks being too small to secure the nation, unquote. This recommendation dovetails with Trump's vows to increase the number of active-duty U.S. soldiers by tens of thousands. Trump's choice continues his reliance on military generals for top positions, which also include General John Kelly as head of the Department of Homeland Security and General James Mattis as defense secretary. President Trump is doubling down on his false claims, Sweden's struggling with immigration-related security problems after he faced widespread criticism and ridicule for appearing to invent a terrorist attack in Sweden while speaking at his 2020 campaign rally in Melbourne, Florida, on Saturday.
Here's the bottom line. We've got to keep our country safe. You look at what's happening. We've got to keep our country safe. You look at what's happening in Germany. You look at what's happening last night in Sweden. Sweden. Who would believe this? Sweden.
Former Swedish Prime Minister Carl Bildt responded to Trump's claim by tweeting, Sweden? Terror attack? What's he been smoking? Questions abound, unquote. Trump later said his comment was in response to a Fox News story he'd watched the night before about alleged refugee-related crime. Sweden's crime rate has fallen over the last decade, even as it's accepted hundreds of thousands of refugees, including people from Syria. On Monday, Trump tweeted, give the public a break. The fake news media is trying to say that large-scale immigration in Sweden is working out just beautifully, not! Swedish Prime Minister Stefan Löfven responded to Trump's claims by highlighting that many things in Sweden are, in fact, working very well.
Do not forget that in international rankings, in issues such as equality, human development, competitiveness, we, like our guest today from Canada, are doing very well.
We'll go to Sweden for more on the story later in the broadcast. 11 Jewish community centers across the country were hit by another wave of bomb threats Monday. It was the fourth wave of nationwide bomb threats against JCCs in the last 5 weeks. In total, 69 threats have been reported against 54 Jewish community centers. Meanwhile, at a cemetery in University City, Missouri, the gravesites of more than 100 Jews were vandalized over the weekend. Paul Goldenberg of the Secure Community Network said, quote, I've been in the business for 20-plus years, and this is unprecedented, unquote. On Monday, President Trump's daughter, Ivanka, tweeted, America is a nation built on the principle of religious tolerance. We must protect our houses of worship and religious centers. Hashtag JCC. In response to Ivanka, New York Congressman Gerald Nadler tweeted, very nice, but this should be coming from your father, real Donald Trump, must directly condemn anti-Semitism and all those who espouse it, unquote. This is Congressman Nadler speaking on CNN this morning.
Maybe he doesn't want to denounce his own supporters. Because some of his own supporters are responsible for this. I mean, certainly the alt-right, Breitbart News was a fountainhead of white nationalism, which includes anti-Semitism and anti-black bigotry.
But instead of speaking out, President Trump chastised a Jewish reporter who's one of Nadler's constituents in Borough Park, Brooklyn, during Trump's news conference and told him to sit down on Thursday when the reporter asked about the bomb threats.
Bomb threats have been made against Jewish centers all across the country in the last couple of weeks. There are people who are committing anti-Semitic acts or threatening to.
You see, he said he was going to ask a very simple, easy question. And it's not.
It's an important
question. It's not. Not a simple question. Not a fair question. Okay, sit down. I understand the rest of your question. So here's the story, folks. Number one, I am the least anti-Semitic person that you've ever seen in your entire life.
In Honduras, indigenous leader José Santos Sevilla has been assassinated by armed gunmen in his home in Montana de la Flor, north of the capital. Santos Sevilla was the leader of the indigenous Tolopan people, who are fighting to protect their ancestral lands from industrial mining and logging projects. In 2015, the United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples warned of rampant violence against Tolopan organizers, including assassinations as well as state impunity for the perpetrators of these crimes. Santos Sevilla's assassination comes only weeks before the anniversary of the assassination of the Honduran indigenous environmental leader, Berta Cáceres, who was killed by armed gunmen in her home on March 2nd as she was leading a struggle against hydroelectric dams threatening the ancestral land of the Lenca people. Ecuador is likely headed for a runoff vote in its presidential election, as front-running candidate Lenin Moreno appears to have narrowly failed to capture 40% of the vote. Moreno served as vice president to outgoing President Rafael Correa. With nearly 90% of the votes counted, he's leading his right-wing rival, former banker Guillermo Lasso, 39% to 28%. Ecuador's election is seen as an indication of whether Latin America's left-leaning so-called pink tide is over, as Argentina, Brazil and Uruguay have all seen right-wing administrations rise to power in recent years. Lasso has said if he were elected, he would throw WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange out of the Ecuadorian embassy in London. The United Nations Children's Agency, UNICEF, is warning as many as 1.4 million children could die this year from famine in Nigeria, Somalia, South Sudan and Yemen. On Monday, famine was declared across parts of South Sudan amidst an ongoing civil war that's led to a near collapse of the economy. In Somalia, the UN says drought has put 185,000 children at risk of famine. In Yemen, the U.S.-backed Saudi-led airstrikes and blockade have led to widespread food and water shortages. In Nigeria, the UN says more than 200,000 children are severely malnourished. Russia's ambassador to the United Nations, Vitaly Churkin, died unexpectedly Monday after collapsing at his desk at the Russian consulate in New York City. He died one day before his 65th birthday. The New York City Medical Examiner's Office is investigating the death. In North Dakota, water protectors at the Ocheti-Sakwan resistance camp are facing an evacuation deadline Wednesday as the fight continues against the $3.8 billion Dakota Access Pipeline. North Dakota Governor Doug Burgum ordered the evacuation. Water protectors are currently cleaning up the camp ahead of the anticipated seasonal flooding of the area. Some water protectors are asking for more time to continue the cleanup. Uber has hired former Attorney General Eric Holder as the company faces allegations of sex harassment from a former engineer in a public blog post titled "Reflecting on One Very, Very Strange Year at Uber." Engineer Susan Fowler-Rigetti wrote about how she was propositioned for sex by a male colleague on her very first day working with a new team at Uber. She says her report of this incident and multiple others were ignored by Uber's human resources department. White nationalist Milo Yiannopoulos is facing widespread backlash after he appeared to endorse pedophilia, leading to the cancellation of upcoming speaking gigs as well as the publication of his book. In his comments, Yiannopoulos discredits age of consent laws and said relationships, quote, between younger boys and older men can be hugely positive experiences, unquote. Simon & Schuster said Monday it canceled publication of Yiannopoulos' book, Dangerous. The American Conservative Union has rescinded an invitation to speak at its upcoming annual conference. Yiannopoulos also faced widespread opposition during his recent speaking tour at universities in the United States, where students were opposed to his long history of making racist, sexist and xenophobic statements. At least two University of California campuses were forced to cancel his speaking events amidst protests. And the historian and activist Marilyn Young has died at the age of 79. She taught at New York University for 35 years and was a pioneering historian of U.S. foreign relations. She was the author of The Vietnam Wars, 1945 to 1990, one of the most important books on the Vietnam War. She was also the editor of countless other books on U.S. militarism, war, and human rights. Young was also a lifelong anti-war activist and a founding member of the Society of Concerned Asian prestigious scholars. In one of her last essays, she wrote, "It's her work as a historian, quote, to speak and write so that a time of war not be mistaken for peacetime, nor waging war for making peace," unquote. Marilyn Young repeatedly appeared on Democracy Now! Over the years, including in 2009, when I asked her about the legacy of Defense Secretary Robert McNamara, who served under Presidents Kennedy and Johnson and played a critical role in escalating the U.S. war in Vietnam.
He almost comes to terms, and then he runs away from coming to terms. And he does the same thing, I think, in Fog of War. And he did that same thing for the whole of the rest of his life, an approach to what he had really been responsible for, and then a bouncing off it, too awful to face. And it happens over and over again.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. As the Trump administration enters its second month, Republican lawmakers have begun a legislative attack on the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, which was created in response to the economic crisis nearly a decade ago. The Bureau was created under the Dodd-Frank legislation, which is also coming under attack by Republican lawmakers and the White House. Last week, President Donald Trump signed an executive order to repeal a Dodd-Frank anti-corruption measure requiring oil and mining companies to disclose payments to foreign governments. He has also vowed to chip away at other parts of the legislation. Earlier in the month, Trump said J.P. Morgan CEO Jamie Dimon was giving him advice on what to do with Dodd-Frank.
We have some of the bankers here. There's nobody better to tell me about Dodd-Frank than Jamie, so you're going to tell me about it. But we expect to be cutting a lot out of Dodd-Frank because, frankly, I have so many people, friends of mine, that have nice businesses. They can't borrow money. They just can't get any money because the banks just won't let them borrow because of the rules and regulations in Dodd-Frank.
One of President Trump's fiercest critics has been Massachusetts Senator Elizabeth Warren, who's spoken out against Trump's efforts to dismantle Dodd-Frank.
The 2008 financial crisis cost millions of people their jobs, their homes, and their savings. And in response, Congress passed the bipartisan Dodd-Frank Act, which aimed to prevent big banks from blowing up the economy again. Now, President Trump has called Dodd-Frank a, quote, disaster, and he has vowed to, quote, dismantle it. He started down that road 2 weeks ago when he issued an executive order on financial regulation, and he's put two men, Steve Mnuchin and Gary Cohn, who have spent a combined 42 years at Goldman Sachs, in charge of rewriting the rules to help big banks like Goldman.
To talk more about what a rollback of Dodd-Frank and the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau would mean for consumers, we are joined by Sheila Kohatkar, a former hedge fund analyst who's now a staff writer at The New Yorker. She's also author of the new book, Black Edge, Inside Information, Dirty Money, and the Quest to Bring Down the Most Wanted Man on Wall Street, which we will also talk about. Sheila, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us.
Thanks for having me.
So let's talk about Dodd-Frank, the people, the bankers that President Trump is surrounding himself by, which might surprise many of his supporters, because he had decried Goldman Sachs and the very banks that he is now deeply involved with. Can you talk about, first of all, Dodd-Frank?
Sure. Well, Dodd-Frank, obviously, was the major legislation passed in the wake of the 2008 financial crisis. It is over 1,000 pages long. It has many critics. There are flaws with it. However, many people, including Elizabeth Warren, who we just saw, agree that it has made the system safer. It has required banks to keep more capital on hand, meaning they have a larger cushion in case they encounter some kind of problems. This was a big issue in 2008. It has pushed the banks to stop doing proprietary trading, which is basically a form of gambling, depending on who you ask, with their own money. And these are taxpayer-backstopped banks. So many people believe that banks should be focused on their stated purpose. Their purpose in the economy is to take capital that people have to invest and channel it to businesses through loans, through IPOs. I mean, they are the engine of the economy, and businesses can't grow without, you know, access to capital, which banks are supposed to provide. And what we've increasingly seen is that banks have become more focused on speculative trading to make money. And this has been a very profitable strategy, although, of course, when it doesn't work out well, it can completely blow up the economy, as we saw. But, you know, really, this legislation is intended to reorient them towards their purpose in our economy, which is helping companies grow and helping the economy grow, not speculation in the market.
But one of the big complaints of banks, as I understand it, has been, one, the requirements now that they not be as leveraged, that they have more assets on hand in case their loans go bad, and also the impact of the financial protection agency that was developed in terms of the limitations on how they can abuse consumers. And I'm wondering now how you're seeing the Trump administration moving in these areas.
Well, of course, the banks and the financial lobby have been screaming and protesting these new rules all the way along. And as we saw, the implementation of Dodd-Frank happened over a period of years. There was intense, drawn-out fighting over every little thing. And now we have this sort of stunning reversal with the new administration in Washington. I mean, as you mentioned, President Trump campaigned—it certainly sounded like he was campaigning against Wall Street. He complained and screamed about bankers all the time and the system being rigged. He criticized Hillary Clinton for giving speeches to Goldman Sachs. But now, I mean, there's a lot of confusion because, of course, there are so many mixed messages coming out of his administration, and we're still trying to figure out what his plans are. But he has basically installed a handful of not quite the same wealthy Wall Street financiers we've seen before, but people, incredibly well-off Wall Street experts who have spent their entire careers in hedge funds, in private equity, at big investment banks, they are the ones advising him on what to do. And it's really hard to believe that those people are going to be reflecting the interests of many of the voters who put Trump into this position in the first place.
Earlier this month, White House Press Secretary Sean Spicer described the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau as an unconstitutional agency.
The Dodd-Frank Act is a disastrous policy that's hindering our markets, reducing the availability of credit, and crippling our economy's ability to grow and create jobs. It imposed hundreds of new regulations on financial institutions while establishing unaccountable and unconstitutional a new agency that does not adequately protect consumers.
So that's Sean Spicer. Your response, Sheila?
Well, I would mention one recent example of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau doing its job, the Wells Fargo scandal. So that was a case where the enormous bank, Wells Fargo, was found to have been pushing its employees and not monitoring them to the point where they were opening up accounts for customers that those customers had not asked for. And this caused widespread damage. It damaged people's credit ratings. People were charged fees. I mean, it was a total scandal. And the CFPB is the one that brought that to light. So I guess my question would be, it's fine to criticize it, but what is your alternative option? Because Republicans have been fighting and trying to water down the powers of this agency since it came into being. It's one thing to say that you want to get rid of it, but I mean, I would really like to hear what their alternative plan is, because we need to know those details, you know?
Well, I want to go back to Senator Elizabeth Warren speaking last week.
Any issue, but especially on something as important as the rules in place to stop another financial crisis, we need to start with facts, real facts, not those alternative facts that the administration has become known for. And the facts show that Donald Trump is wrong and his chief economic advisor is wrong about every major reason that they've given to tear up Dodd-Frank. Commercial and consumer lending is robust, bank profits are at record levels, and our banks are blowing away their global competitors. So, why go after banking regulations? The president and the team of Goldman Sachs bankers that he has put in charge of the economy want to scrap the rules so they can go back to the good old days when bankers could take huge risks and get huge bonuses if they got lucky, knowing that they could get taxpayer bailouts if their bets didn't pay off. We did this kind of regulation before, and it resulted in the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression. We cannot afford to go down this road again.
That was Senator Elizabeth Warren last week. And what about this issue of why the banks so badly want to get rid of these regulations? And also the tie to the subject of your book, which is hedge funds and the involvement of banks, even with hedge funds. Yes.
Well, so the period that I really describe in this book, it was like a flowering of insider trading in the hedge fund world that the government kind of investigated and cracked down on. But a lot of that took root from the mid 2000s to 2008, 2009, 2010, when they really started to crack down on it. And I think it's really important to put it in context. I mean, a lot of this crime that I write about happened during the same period of time when the mortgage fraud housing bubble inflated that literally blew up and led to the financial crisis. And this coincided with a period of serious deregulation in Washington. And in fact, during many of those key years, the head of the SEC, which is responsible for policing the market and making sure it's fair for everyone, he did not believe in regulation. The chairman, Christopher Cox, essentially said markets can regulate themselves. He discouraged SEC attorneys from bringing enforcement actions against people on Wall Street. They did not—they were discouraged from even interviewing prominent financiers. I mean, they were supposed to kind of take a hands-off approach. And look what happened at the end of it. We had this huge blow-up of crime and fraud. And, you know, I would argue that we are still paying the price for that. And the dynamic that was created at that moment led to widening income inequality, and I think that has contributed directly to the situation we're in
now. We're going to talk more about your book, Sheila, after this break. Sheila Kolhatkar is a staff writer at The New Yorker. Her book is quite remarkable, very hard to put down, Black Edge, Inside Information, Dirty Money, and the Quest to Bring Down the Most Wanted Man on Wall Street. After that, we're going to Stockholm to see what did happen in Sweden last night. And finally, to England, where almost 2 million people have signed a petition to stop the state visit of President Trump. Stay with us. That's Heartbeats by The Knife, a Swedish band, and we'll be going to Stockholm in a moment. But first, we're continuing with Sheila Kolhatkar, staff writer at The New Yorker and the author of Black Edge, Inside Information, Dirty Money, and the Quest to Bring Down the Most Wanted Man on Wall Street. Explain the term Black Edge, Sheila.
So it's important to understand that hedge funds are driven by information. And if you're trading in the stock market each day on a kind of a short-term speculative basis, the better the information is that you have, the more money you're going to make. That's the general philosophy. So everyone is out there trying to get good, usable information. Inside the hedge fund that I write about a lot in this book, SAC Capital, you know, they had different categories of information. There was white edge, which is publicly available information that anyone can get, like information that is in an SEC filing that a company makes. Not very useful to a trader because everyone already has that. There's gray edge, which is in the gray zone. It might be something that an executive at the company told you, but it wasn't entirely clear what they meant. You're not quite sure. You're sort of you might have to talk to your legal counsel before you can trade on that information. And then there's black edge, which is clearly material, non-public information, inside information. For example, access to confidential drug trial results before they are released. And a person could make a lot of money trading on that kind of information.
Well, one of the fascinating things about your book, aside from the fact it's a great storytelling, is the way you describe the evolution of the hedge fund world from basically a strategy of investment to, in essence, totally unregulated gambling, a sort of like a dark world of Wall Street in general, where anything goes and where the illegal insider information became such a valuable commodity in that world.
Well, so there are thousands of hedge funds now, and of course they all do different things, and some of them are fine and some of them are not so fine. But really, the whole idea of a hedge fund began decades ago. The idea was that you could create an investment fund where you could hedge your investments. So if you went long certain stocks, you could also short other stocks, which means you were betting that the price would go down, and that would kind of offset your losses if the market went down, you know, so you were kind of hedging your bets. And this was attractive to wealthy investors, and the regulators decided that if only wealthy investors were using these funds, they would give them more latitude to take risk in the market. So they could borrow more money. They could do this shorting. And it started off as this little niche thing, but it was so successful. And many of the people running these funds became so wealthy. I mean, billions of dollars at early ages.
Well, as you say, Stephen Cohen was reporting 30% returns every year.
He was. Year after year, his hedge fund, SAC Capital, posted 30, 50, 70% in its early days, 100%, and investors were fighting to get in. And by the time the events that I write about in this book really come to a head, you know, he had only had one down year, which was 2008, financial crisis year.
So we don't have much time, and you spent hundreds of pages that were hard not to read, to say the least. Telling us the story of SAC Capital and Stephen Cohen. Tell us what happened.
Well, ultimately, the FBI decided they were going to try and crack down on the hedge fund industry, and they kept hearing the name SAC all over the place from different informants on wiretaps. So they started to look into it. And over a period of several years, they used the same techniques they'd used to investigate the mob. They ended up charging a handful of people who worked at SAC, and there was a lot of—
SAC, Stephen A. Cohen.
So it stands for Stephen A. Cohen. Those are his initials. So Stephen A. Cohen's hedge fund, SAC Capital, it was a $15 billion fund at its peak, very powerful force in the market. And ultimately, the government had to make a decision about whether they were going to charge Cohen himself. And this is where he becomes, I think, sort of the man of our time, because there was this huge debate. The press was watching. A lot of anticipation. Is this huge Wall Street titan going to possibly face jail time?
Like the guy on the corner who steals $10.
Exactly. Unlike the low-level drug dealer who's definitely going to jail. I mean, there was a huge debate about this. Everybody was waiting to see, and the government ultimately decided they did not have the evidence they needed to definitively prove that Steve Cohen knew this illegal activity was taking place. And that is true. They did not have a witness. They did not have a wiretap. They did not have anything that definitively showed that Steve Cohen knew this was going on, even though the circumstantial evidence looked quite bad. So they ended up charging the company instead, SAC Capital. And Mr. Cohen ended up paying almost $2 billion in fines. And the hedge fund was shut down. But he can return to the industry in 2018. And I would argue that this story is important for everyone because we all have money in the stock market now. I mean, Americans have largely been pushed to put their retirement savings in the stock market. And what you see through this story is that there are two markets. There's one.
So is the moral of the story then that unlike a previous era when Milken and others were convicted, that the biggest of these Wall Street giants now have figured out a way to be able to get around the law?
Well, after the financial crisis, the same thing happened. We did not see any senior-level bankers even facing the possibility of going to jail, and they largely resolved the criminal activity from that scandal through fines. So I think this has caused a lot of frustration for the American public who—
Well, clearly Stephen Cohen's lawyers were very good.
Yes.
Kevin O'Connor, it was reported by Bloomberg in November, the general counsel for for Stephen Cohen's investment firm, oversaw the staff picks for the Justice Department as a member of President Donald Trump's transition team, according to a chart named by Bloomberg.
I thought that was just about a perfect ending to the story, based on the way things are going. But I believe—I mean, that was reported, and it seemed to be only for a brief time. But yes, it does appear that people from Cohen's world and his industry have now moved into Washington, and they are directing economic policy and regulatory policy. And this is something we all need to be concerned about. And I don't think it's going to resolve the frustrations of the voters who put Trump in that position.
Do you think Donald Trump will ever release his tax returns?
It doesn't look like it, but I mean, I think it's a scandal. I can't believe he hasn't had to do it, but look where he's gotten without releasing them. So I don't see any incentive for him to do so now, frankly.
And his claim that the American people don't care about this?
Well, obviously, it depends on who you ask. A lot of people do care. And that kind of transparency is really important. I mean, it's a problem when we do not know, as a people, who our president is financially beholden to. And ultimately, most stories, I think, in Washington come down to money. So we do not know where the money trail goes, and we should have that information. And it's very upsetting that we don't.
Well, I hear there are plans for an April 15th Trump taxes march on Washington. So we'll see what happens. Sheila Kolhatkar, I want to thank you for being with us. Staff
Thanks.
Writer at The New Yorker, author of the new book, Black Edge, Inside Information, Dirty Money, and the Quest to Bring Down the Most Wanted Man on Wall Street. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
Well, President Trump is doubling down on his false claim that Sweden is struggling with immigration-related security problems after he faced widespread criticism and ridicule for appearing to invent a terrorist attack in Sweden while speaking at a campaign rally in Melbourne, Florida, on Saturday.
Here's the bottom line. We've got to keep our country safe. You look at what's happening. We've got to keep our country safe. You look at what's happening in Germany. You look at what's happening last night in Sweden. Sweden. Who would believe this? Sweden. They took in large numbers. They're having problems like they never thought possible.
Former Swedish Prime Minister Carl Bildt responded to Trump's claim by tweeting, quote, Sweden, terror attack? What has he been smoking? Questions abound, unquote. Trump later said his comment was in response to a Fox News story he'd watched the night before about alleged refugee-related crime. Sweden's crime rate has fallen over the last decade, even as it has accepted hundreds of thousands of refugees, including from Syria.
On Monday, President Trump tweeted, give the public a break. The fake news media is trying to say that large-scale immigration in Sweden is working out just beautifully. Not! Exclamation point. Well, Swedish Prime Minister Stefan Löfven responded to Trump's claims by highlighting many things in Sweden are, in fact, working very well.
It's up to the president to decide what he wants to say. I can only say the World Economic Forum states that, written, why Sweden beats other countries at just about everything. OECD reports that we have a very strong economic development in terms of, for example, GDP per capita. The European Commission states that Sweden is Europe's most innovative country. The Global Innovation Index says Sweden is number two when it comes to innovative countries. So we have some very strong facts that shows that Sweden is also handling a situation. But as I said, yes, we have challenges, like all other countries. There's no doubt we have a situation in the world where 65 million people had to flee the countries last year or the year before that. 65 million. So that's a worry for us together.
There has been one recent terror attack in Sweden. Three neo-Nazis attacked the Gothenburg Asylum Center in January with a homemade bomb.
One person was seriously injured. According to The Independent, the suspects were members of the Nordic Resistance Movement, which opposes non-white immigration to Sweden. Well, for more, we're going to Stockholm, where we're joined by Mattias Gardell, professor of comparative religion and head of the Center for Multidisciplinary Studies and Racism at Uppsala University in Sweden. We welcome you, professor, to Democracy Now! So talk about what you started to hear on Saturday night, when President Trump, at his campaign rally for 2020, talked about what happened in Sweden, quote, last night.
Well, to us, it's absolutely amazing that a president could be that detached from empirical reality as Mr. Trump. And had it not had such dire consequences for the U.S. population, possibly the world, it had been entertaining. Last night, it actually did happen, a suspected terrorist attack. It was a Muslim association house that was burnt down, and possibly by people connected to the anti-Muslim, neo-fascist scene here. You know, similar to the ones you cited before with the bombing attacks made suspected to be made by people from the National Nordic Resistance Movement. And they are all jubilant because they see Mr. Trump as their man.
And
Sweden is a place where, you know, it doesn't really happen that much. It's quite quiet, but terrorism has skyrocketed in 2015 and 2016. Last year alone, it was 92 suspected attacks. But they were all against asylum seekers, home for refugees, and probably made by the same political milieu that supports Trump.
And what about the overall crime situation in the country? The critics of Sweden's asylum policy say that crime has been rising as a result of its welcoming so many foreign asylum seekers and refugees into the country.
That's another illustration of alternative facts. In fact, for a decade or more, crime rates, especially violent crime rates, have been going down. And if you judge by or compare by capita, United States has five times as much murders as has Sweden. So it's not true.
And can you respond to President, to—well, let me ask you this. I want to turn to an interview from Fox News' Tucker Carlson tonight that might have precipitated Donald Trump's comments in some odd, twisted way. Carlson interviewed the right-wing filmmaker Ami Horowitz about his documentary on refugee violence in Sweden. Carlson asked Horowitz about the long-term effects of Sweden's open-door policy toward asylum seekers.
We don't have to actually prognosticate on what the long game is. You can look at France and Belgium, because they've been doing it for that period of time, for longer. And you can see the social unrest that's going on there, the terrorism that's happening there. Sweden, this is a relatively new policy, a phenomenon for them. And by the way, Sweden had its first terrorist Islamic attack not that long ago. So they're now getting the taste of what we've been seeing across Europe already.
So that was the conversation that took place Friday night. Saturday night, Donald Trump talked about that, talked about terrorist attacks and then referred to Sweden. He said, we all knew what happened last night. And when there was a great deal of outcry and when the Swedish embassy asked for clarification in Washington, he said he had watched television the night before. I guess that's what happened last night. But the response to that and also the uptick in hate crimes and terror attacks in Sweden that are actually being committed, and I don't think this is what Donald Trump was referring to, by neo-Nazis.
That is true. I mean, it was so many mistakes in that right-wing anti-Muslim filmmakers. His so-called documentary was all a fabrication of alternative facts. Sweden does not, in fact, have an open-door policy. One of the problems is that we have sealed our borders and preventing people seeking to refuge and seeking asylum for coming into the country. And we all know what consequences that has in human life, drowned in the Mediterranean. And when it comes to the rise of the very militant anti-Muslim, neo-Nazi or proto-fascist movement, that's a subject of great concern to us here in Sweden. And we have a proto-fascist party elected into parliament that now, according to surveys, is the second largest party. And this has not happened before in Swedish history. And behind them is this whole industry of social media that also informs President Trump. So it's of great concern to us now. And you could see that fascism is returning with a vengeance to Europe, maybe dressed in a way that we don't necessarily recognize it as fascism, because we have had this Hollywood stereotyping of National Socialism and fascism, that we expect fascism to be the only ideology that doesn't really change. We don't recognize people as fascists if they don't come dressed as in the Second World War II, mediated by Hollywood, and that's of great concern. And this is not what happened only in Sweden, it's across all over Europe. And maybe we will have a new axis forming with this strong populist, ultra-nationalist white men. You know, Trump, Putin, Orbán in Hungary, Zeman in the Czech Republic. Let's see what's going to happen in France. The same kind of movement is also gaining strength in Sweden. And it's quite deadly. And it comes also at the... in a very precarious time in Sweden, because we now live 25 years into the experiment of neoliberalism that really undermined the so-called Swedish model and transformed Sweden into a society that has the greatest levels of segregation, for instance, and also differences between the classes in the whole OECD region. And lots of people in Sweden are concerned now about their future and the future of their kids. And fascism, as we know, is not a right-wing extremism as much as it is an extremism of the center. It comes from the people who claim that we belong to those who built this country, and now we cannot afford to accept more people. And they all built on contrafactual news because or facts, because we all know that in terms of GNP, Sweden has actually benefited from accepting more people coming in. It's simple economy. If the country grows larger, more people live here, the economy will also get a boost. But fascism is not only spreading its agenda with references to empirical facts, but it also has a very strong affective dimension. And this sort of affective dimension today formulated by the ultra-nationalists, this sort of fascist vision. And you see the same phenomena in the U.S. So they are all really interconnected, and this causes us great concern at the moment.
Well, but Professor Gardell, in terms of, you mentioned the economic problems that have created the basis for the rise of fascism. What about the issue of race? As Sweden, like many other European countries, has become more multiracial than it was in the past, how has that affected the rise of fascist tendencies within the country?
Could you please repeat the question? I couldn't hear you.
I said, what about the issue of race and the rise of racism in terms of the rise of fascism in Sweden, as a country, like many other European countries, has become more multiracial than it was in the past?
That's true, but it's also true that Sweden has never been a homogeneous nation. We have had national minorities such as the Roma people here for half a millennium. And so the image of a homogeneous Sweden doesn't really exist. But it's true now that racism has risen and become normalized. If you look at structural racism, for example, it's very easy to see from research that if you have a Muslim name, you will have much harder to try to get a job according to your qualifications in competition with people with non-Muslim or Swedish names. So structural racism is strong. And also these movements now that has gained from the global spread of anti-Muslim rhetoric that started actually already at the fall of the wall and gained, you know, a breakthrough with 9/11 has just continued to gain momentum. And very much so due to this industry of alternative facts.
Professor Gardell, we want to thank you for being with us. Professor Matthias Gardell is a professor of comparative religion and leads the Center for Multidisciplinary Studies and Racism at Uppsala University in Sweden. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, we head to London, where massive protests have been taking place. More than close to 2 million people online have called for the state visit of President Trump to be canceled. Stay with us. The Opposite of Hallelujah by Jens Lekman, a Swedish musician. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
Well, nearly 2 million Brits have signed a petition calling on President Trump's official state visit to be canceled. On Monday, thousands of protesters gathered outside Parliament in London as British lawmakers debated whether to deny Trump a formal state visit. Inside Parliament, MPs debated for 3 hours. This is Labour MP Naz Shah.
In the last 31 days, what we have seen has in many ways been chilling. The executive orders that have dominated Donald Trump's first weeks in the White House have been frightening. And the question many of us are asking, where does this slippery slope really lead? Mm-hmm. If we take only one of the groups of people he has sought to divide, those of a Muslim faith, not necessarily distinct to one country or another, his rhetoric has been so broad that even I, personally, as a Muslim, feel attacked and misrepresented. And no doubt many of my constituents who make wonderful contributions to this country on a daily basis feel the same way. We have to take every opportunity to show that his negativity and divisive messages are not going to divide us. And just as importantly, we cannot let them define us.
Meanwhile, Tory MP Julian Lewis said he supported the state visit and hopes the United Kingdom can influence Trump, who he referred to as a, quote, inexperienced individual. This is Conservative MP Jacob Rees-Mogg, followed by the Labour Party's Paul Flynn.
What complaint did the honourable gentleman make when Emperor Hirohito came here, who was responsible for the rape of Nanking?
Certainly, we can't try to imitate the errors of the past. We should set an example by making sure that we don't make those mistakes again.
For more, we're going to London, where we're joined by Asad Rehman of Friends of the Earth International, who spoke at the protest outside Parliament yesterday. Asad, thanks so much for being with us again. We usually speak to you at the UN Climate Summit, wherever it is happening in the world. Talk about what's happening right now and what you think is going to happen with this state visit of President Trump.
Well, since the President Trump's various executive orders targeting Muslim with the Muslim ban, and of course his outrageous comments are against women and migrant communities, the normalizing of a really of hatred, bigotry, and xenophobia. A large number of British people, and I think right across the political spectrum, find it absolutely abhorrent that this government should roll out a red carpet for President Trump. And the state visit is an honour that is bestowed by the UK government. It's not something that happens automatically. And nearly 2 million people signed a petition asking the government to withdraw its offer of a state visit. Hundreds of thousands of people have now been mobilising on the streets. In fact, yesterday was the fourth big mobilisation that there's been to send a message to this government that they should listen to the British people. And there has been already a commitment that if Donald Trump steps inside this country, and when he does, that there will be a huge mobilisation. We intend to put millions of people on the street, not only to oppose Donald Trump and his agenda, but also to hold up a mirror about what's happening both in the UK and across Europe. And listening to your previous guest, talking about the normalisation of racism and attacks on migrants and refugees, talking about how we are slowly moving into a space where the far-right and extreme right-wing parties are dominating our political space, and how we have to be able to oppose that, and we have to actively oppose that. And to do that, we need to build a movement that is much more inclusive and brings together a different spectrum of views and organisations. And that's why Friends of the Earth, we're one of the organisers of the Stop Trump Coalition, and we, together with trade unions, Muslim organisations, migrant organisations, have been organising these huge protests that have been taking place, because we think that this struggle for climate justice, for climate refugees, is a struggle for justice, and it's the same struggle against whether we're talking against sexism, sexist violence, racism or bigotry.
And Asad, I wanted to ask you about Theresa May, the prime minister, who's obviously extended her hand to Trump, and her relationship, her reaction to what's happened here. And of course, famously, when she did visit Washington, Trump tried to grab her hand as they were walking in the White House, and she pulled back.
Well, that image, I think, will live on in most people's minds, and it sort of sums up the picture and of that relationship. I mean, many people felt, you know, that, of course, we're in a post-Brexit world, and the UK has voted in the referendum last year to leave the European Union. There's a great deal of uncertainty as to what that actually means. Many people are arguing for a hard Brexit, which could lead to real crisis in terms of our economy and jobs. And, of course, the issue of migration is being played very much by some forces to justify a vote to leave the European Union. Now, all of those things means that this government is basically willing to accept anything from the US administration. And that's part of what I think has angered so many people, that what the UK is hoping, that by cozying up to Donald Trump, by accepting the kind of views that he's espousing, that somehow we will manage to get a trade deal. Unfortunately, we know what kind of trade deal that will be. The trade deal will be that we will have given up our rights, we would have given up decency, we would have accepted this agenda of hatred, and in return, we would have had a trade deal of deregulation, of weakening labour laws, environment protection. We would have had to give up in terms of our controls around our food, our health, and all of those things are I think, unacceptable. And all of that is part of the agenda of actually making Theresa May say, take a step back and think again about rolling out this red carpet.
We want to go back to Monday's parliamentary debate on whether the state visit of Donald Trump should be cancelled. Green Party MP Caroline Lucas said Trump's climate change denials alone should disqualify him from being invited.
Many of them have raised not only Trump's misogyny and racism, but also his contempt for basic climate science. Would the honourable member agree that to have a state visit for someone who has shown such effrontery to basic climate science is another reason to say that he should not be coming here?
So that was inside Parliament, as thousands were outside. What's coming of this vote, and what actually will happen?
Well, the vote is not a binding vote, but I think it was very clear from the speakers who spoke in Parliament yesterday, the number of people who contacted their members of Parliament, that the overwhelming majority of members of Parliament also oppose that this government, the state visit of Donald Trump. We've heard unprecedented that the Speaker of the House, one of the most powerful positions in the House of Commons, has himself said he thinks it's absolutely inappropriate that if Donald Trump comes on a state visit, that he should be allowed the honour of speaking in Parliament to our Parliament, both the House of Commons and House of Lords. This is an incredible rejection of Donald Trump and his agenda, and we heard it last night, and we heard it from right across the political spectrum, and it's really now up to the government to listen to those voices. Because we have been here in the past where, of course, we have had a prime minister who has been willing to accept an American agenda, and that led us into a really disastrous war. 2 million people marched on the street. And, of course, that prime minister's reputation is in tatters now. And I think there's a stark warning to Theresa May that cozying up to Donald Trump could end up with her and her reputation being in similar tatters.
Well, we want to thank you for being with us, Asad Rehman, spokesperson for Friends of the Earth International. That does it for our show. Belated happy birthday to Neil Shabata. Democracy Now! Is produced by Mike Burke, Nermeen Sheikh, Carla Wills, Laura Gottesdiener, Nardina Guzder, Sam Alkoff, Robbie Karen, Hani Massoud, Shereen Ndura, and Andre Lewis. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez for another edition of Democracy Now!